Okay, thank you. Thank you for coming to the early afternoon plenary keynote session. And today's speaker is Professor Yoshi Nakamura from the Tokyo University, or University of Tokyo. He is, in his background, a mechanical engineer, getting his PhD degree from Kyoto University, if I remember. Then he spent several years in Santa Barbara, UC Santa Barbara, and then went back to Tokyo, and since then he's been in the Tokyo University, where he has a lab. His focus is on humanoids, neuromuscular systems, and basically he's working hard on modeling the human body, I think in with the goal of using these models to design humanoids. But he will tell us more about that. And he has written a lot. He has had several best paper awards, and I think he may be the only one who has two best paper awards on the transaction of robotics automation, how to predict transaction of robotic automation. So I've known him for a long time, and it's a very great pleasure for me to invite him to give this talk. So please.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Zubishira. It is my great pleasure to be here since I was in the California. I was in UC Santa Barbara, and the Professor Zubishira was in UC Los Angeles. We were sometimes helping each other and competing with each other to get funding as the young faculty members in the University of California many years ago. And we have been a good friend since then. And I'm also here as the representative of Ecton. Ecton is one of the sponsoring societies of this conference. And the end of the 60s or early 70s, there was the political change at that time. The two famous politicians are discussing about how to resolve the difficult problem. East and West. But a few years before then, the scientists already started the discussion about how to keep the good communication between East and West. And the IFTOM was established at the time in 1969. The IFTOM is the International Federation of Promotion Mechanism and Machine Science, and there's only 46 members, only a small number of members, but one member means a country. And Israel is one of the member countries. So everyone studying or from this country is being supported as a regular member of EFTOM. And you will be applied the discounted membership fee for sponsored conferences. And I have to also explain the Romancy. This is the very traditional robotics conference, probably the oldest robotics conference established. And there are many important papers published. And the Professor Bernie Ross is here. Actually, it is the famous ex-president of the IFTOM. And Professor Bernie Ross was the president many years ago. And I'm happy to be a president in this town and supporting the all activities of the IFTOM. And really happy to be here again to congratulate the Professor Zubishira and many of the IFTOM colleagues in Israel. And I'm really happy to be able to talk in front of you about our recent research on the human models and human design. Well, by the way, this is the photograph of somewhere in the Jerusalem yesterday. I had a chance to go there, and it was a nice day, and I learned that the history of humans or civilization has been here for a long time, very impressive. And this is another scene which Professor Zubishira invited me for the dinner a few days ago. And of course there is a lot of the human like culture around. So I'm talking about humanoid, but this is very much related to human culture, human civilization. So we know what is the human civilization, human culture, city plan, traffic systems, architecture, economics, any design. These are based on how we use and how we live at home or office or any other public environment. Well, culture is also important. I was asking the first of the conference, this conference, to Professor Monsieur, and he suggested me to have a tie and shirt, but he also mentioned he and you will be the only two people having a tie in this conference. I don't know if this is true or not, but dress code is another culture, and there are many rules or code that we know, and we intentionally or unintentionally follow these rules. This is a very important subject. So we are living in the system of rules, a system of symbols. And I think the robot or computer system from now on in the future, you have to understand some rules and some culture of humans. This is the key issue. And this is the central problem of robot intelligence and the central problem of human robotics, that is one of the most important field of robotics. I have to also explain about the disaster that came to Japan 2 years ago. This was the peaceful scenery of the Fukushima Daiichi electric power plant, nuclear power plant, before the March 11th of 2011. And the nuclear power plant is a huge plant, and it is a very artificial system, and it is automated a lot. And there are many huge technology or automation technology already developed and equipped to those facilities. And there are many technologies that have been developed and applied. And many robot systems are also applied and being used for a long time. But after the earthquake and the tsunami, March 11th, 2011, three of the six plants in the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant had the hydrogen explosions, and there are many difficult problems. And there are many discussions and many trials to investigate what's going wrong and how to fix it. And it turned out that the inside of the nuclear plant is actually human structured environment. And the, one of the oldest plant has been made a lot of change. And there are a lot of the stairs and also the ladders and catwalks for humans, only for humans. And it's not for automated environment inside for maintenance. Of course, there are many huge machines and maintenance systems, but for emergencies or for difficult cases, the human operators and human beings have to be there, and it is designed in that way. Well, the already many robots have been applied. As you can see, the outside, you can see the panel of the Quintec company, and also the Hackbot from iRobot. Okay, so I want to explain with this, the Hackbot is the mobile robot system which has been applied to the Fukushima plant. I think it was in April 17th, about a month after the explosion. And this was the first robot to enter the facilities. but the platform is already quite small. However, it couldn't go up the stairs. And as of the middle of July, the one of the robotics robot systems in Japan was modified and applied inside. And the Phoenix was able to go into the stairs and the catwalk and ladders. But there are many other difficulties. The, for example, in the some part of the catwalk, the floor is not just a simple floor. It is made of the net and very complicated structures. And the mobile system with the wings cannot go through. So the company Toshiba developed and applied the quad-lapped robot system. It might not be able to believe, but the left locomotion system was more useful in those difficult environments. And the, already the, this year, the quad-lapped robot system was applied to go up the stairs and walk around the net floors and inspect the nuclear power plant. So the, those environment, again, I could say it is extremely difficult environment, but only human could be able to reach and go. And it is expected that robot is being able to apply for those very difficult and sad environment. And very recently, the DARPA has launched the what is known as DARPA Robotics Challenge. This is quite controversial because the military applications and robotics are quite sensitive issues. But however, the this is real hard challenge and big event for robotics systems. The within this DARPA Robotics Challenge, the 8 trials are planned. And a single robot has to go through all of 8 trials, including driving a car, walking in the floor with a lot of levels, and open the door, and going up the ladders, and turning the bubbles, I mean, balloons. So many works are expected to be done only by a single robot. And it is not mandatory to be a humanoid robot, but it must be able to work in the human environment and must be able to handle human equipment. These are the requirements for the robot in this difficult environment. Many years ago, I proposed the humanoid robot in the moon and on the moon. Actually, this proposal was not accepted and successful, but the idea was for the manned exploration on the moon. I think it is one idea to send a human-like robot first and make human environment by themselves. And then the robot can build up the human environment and human can go there and work together in the difficult environment. I think this is one way that the human environment is being built by a robot. And those robots should be able to have some geometric relationship with humans, including ergonomics. Well, already Professor Bernie Ross explained about the Boxster from the Lissing Robotics. This is not a biped robot, but two-arm human-like structure. And this robot is a revolutionary event in many robotics fields because it is a robot working with humans and easy communication between human and robot. So these are the direction of robot that has been happening right now, and also technology is being supporting in this way. And this is another robot. This was developed by Kawada Industries of Japan, and this robot has been working. 7 of them are working in the human assembly line, and one company called Rolling, and they are making ATM or coin exchangers and many other automatic machines. But as you can see, seven of them are working in the same assembly line with the people. So there are a lot of technical development and concerns, and there are, of course, informatics problems. But it is getting very common and important that robot works with human, in the human environment. Well, again, I think the robot has to understand human environment. Robot has to understand how human consider its manner or its way to be communicate, to establish a communication. For example, if robot have to give some parts to the robot, there is some trajectory or there should be some profile velocity or acceleration that we feel more comfortable. If robot give a parts, very heavy parts this way, it's very dangerous and we don't think it's very comfortable. I think there should be nice common way that we can accept the style of motions. So in our lab, we have been working on the system of symbols for a long time, maybe nearly 15 years. So I'm going to show some of them, and I'm going to show a very fundamental part of technology. So the idea is that it is quite simple. So we want to build the simple system of human motions. Human motion is, of course, continuous, not discrete system. But we can, for example, if I asked to interpret human motion, I can explain with some words, Japanese or English. So in that sense, we can segment the motion into pieces, and we can interpret them verbally or by symbols. This is how we perceive the human motions and human activities. Actually, I think this is not only humans, animals are understanding in that way. This is, of course, my assumptions. But what we did is that we developed the mathematics to segment the motions. You can see some flash in this picture. So whenever it detects the end of segment, it flashes, but the character changes here. So there is some dynamical system we developed, and that can detect the end of segment and the beginning of segment. So in that way, we can cut the continuous motion in pieces, and then we can correct them and represent by a point, system of points. And this is what we call the proto-symbol space. So we can collect many motions and build their relationship. And relationship is represented by the distance between the point in this way. Actually, we applied this system for communication between robot and human. I can show in more detail about this. And then the idea of symbol, as I already said, I can interpret the human motions. That means not only discretizing the motion, I can connect the segment with the word. So the symbol system and language system is very closely related, of course. This is why we studied the segmentation of symbol systems. And the mathematics we developed for segmentation and using symbol system is the stochastic mathematics. So statistical mathematics. And the same statistical mathematics can be or has been used quite widely for the natural language processing or language systems in computers. So we can quite naturally combine the linguistic or language system with motions. And I can explain more detail. Maybe later. Okay, so this is the a scene of my lab, and the Dr. Dongji Li was communicating with robot. And you can see your heart, but you can see some markers on her body. And she's being observed by camera, 10 of the cameras, and her motion is captured by the camera. And then her motion, it was understood by symbol system. And the pattern of her motion is explained this way by the numbers. Now, the her motion is number one, and then number nine, or something like this. So her motion is being interpreted, segmented, and then interpreted. And then the robot will identify what kind of motion he's supposed to do based on the symbol wizard we have made this system. And then, more importantly, it's not just a playing between robot and human. And they need to physically touch, and they need to reach hand at the same time. So synchronization and physical touch must be considered in addition to the motion patterns. So this is what is called the physical human interactions, PHRI. So the symbol system, not only just for recalling the motion pattern, but also being used for physical motion or physical task in this way. This is the one of the topics we are talking about. So about the mathematics, I can just say it's very standard mathematics, but it is known as the statistical system, and some people call it the hidden map of knowledge. It's a discrete event system, but the events are represented by the statistics. And what is very interesting to us is that this statistic system can be applied to compute the probability of the motion when we see the motion. Also, by this system, we can create most likely motions. So this system can act in two ways, to perceive what is the current motion of the person. And also, this system can be used to create a motion when necessary. So this kind of equipment in the neural system, sometimes called the mirror neurons, in the brain of human or animals. So I think this is, we were motivated by mirror neurons when we developed this system a long time ago. And the mathematics, I don't want to explain in detail, but it is the discrete event system with the sequence of node, and the change of node is being represented by probability. And we need to identify the probability, but the mathematics, statistical mathematics has very good input to compute these mathematics. So having these, the Hidden Markov model, our idea was to use it for communication between human robot. So we prepared the pen of the Hidden Markov model for the robot. And robot understand the human motions with this set of Hidden Markov model. And then robot tried to act using this Hidden Markov model. Actually, we prepared two-layer Hidden Markov model. In the first layer, as I explained, the computer or robot system will identify the type of motion. And then the second Hidden Markov model will identify the relationship between human and robot. And then create the robot motion by simply connecting in this way. This is very simple relationship. So this is the demonstration we showed at IG Expo in year 2005. So this is our human robot with 20 joints, 20 motors, 60 centimeter high. We developed this robot, and the human is the one of our master's children. They are fighting each other maybe 5 meters at a distance, and they cannot fight each other. The size is different, and we don't want to see the human robot is going to be damaged. So they are fighting at a distance, but in the screen, they are actually fighting in the same size at more closer distance. And when one hit the chest of the other part, he or not can get the point. This is a kind of game. But this is a communication. I could say it's a hostile or maybe competitive communication. But this communication can be done with the symbol system. Probably this is a fast real-time communication system done by a symbol system. So we also developed the other system, what they call crystal ball. So after this is a person, and he's playing some well-known exercise, what we call radio exercise, number two, I guess. This is established long time ago. And his motion is actually segmented automatically, and segmented data is stored in this way. So the one past segment is this, the dark color, and the old segment is moving in the right-hand side and stored in this way. So we can automatically and in real time cut the motion into pieces and store it in this way. For example, the segmented motion, one of the segmented motions is something like this. This is motion 81, this is motion 82. So these are automatically segmented and stored. And then, what we can do is this. So we can segment the motion, as I already explained. But at the same time, using those data, we can predict his motion. His motion in the future. This is one segment ahead of time. This is two segments ahead of time. So since this is a known motion, we can do this. But even for unknown motion, if we could assume that human motion is categorized, we may be able to predict the human motion a few seconds ahead of time. For example, this is the data set we store from this motion, and this is the temporal sequence of the motions. And using this temporal sequence, we can identify the next motions. Actually, if we collect more data, the data structure becomes huge to the structure like this. I think the human knowledge about human motion is something like this. We have equipped with many data, and we know, and we can use them to predict their motions. This is the subway map of Tokyo. Actually, it is very complicated, but if we know what line you are on, then looking at the stations, you can predict the next station, probably. So I think the human motion is a kind of lines. And looking at the stations, looking at few segments, you can predict the next station. So collecting a lot of human data, we can use them predicting the human behaviors. Okay, so naturally we combine these human data with a text or language system. And I can show some result. So the language system and text data and motion data, again, they have a very common statistical data. And okay, so this is the work of my colleague, Professor Wataru Takano. And by showing the motion data, his system picks up several words statistically, and then selects the most likely word in static sense. So the three sentences are created in this way. So in this case, a player plays a harp, a student walk, a person smokes, housewife clean up, a player toss, and student play table tennis, student read books, musician plays piano. So it doesn't understand who is housewife, who is student, who is player, but it's just we statistically infer the world and connect them statistically. Same language system can be used to create the motion of the robot. And this is just kinematic motion and nothing dynamic or no control yet. But if we can, if we make a student wear a shirt, a robot can make this kind of motion. So we have to solve many other problems like collision or dynamics or control. But using this, the inference engine, the robot system can create a motion pattern that we expect by word or sentence or simple system. So I think this kind of technology will be a fundamental technology for the system and involving human robot. And I think the communication between robot and human has been important sense, not only the face-to-face communication, but also teleoperation in the case of the decommissioning of the nuclear power plant, or maybe exploration in the space or moon, like this. So one of our student is working on using simple system for communication, simple system for teleoperations. And the, this is not very deep work yet, but the idea is to combine a simple knowledge system for the teleoperations. For example, if I want to grasp something in the virtual space, the robot has to understand what I'm reaching for and what kind of object I'm trying to grasp. So those kind of knowledge is transferred and symbolically combined. And this is what we want to do. Okay, so the simple system is not just the motion pattern and language. When we are looking at the football game, we can find out and we can feel how hardly or strongly a player hits a soccer ball or others. So I think the human sensation is another thing that robot or computer should understand. So we have been making the anatomical model of human. This is one way to simulate the sensation of human. And using the very standard robotics technology of kinematics and dynamics, we developed the system of bone and muscles, including nearly 1,000 wires as a model of muscles. And computation is very straightforward. We apply the kinematics and dynamics computation. And what is most important is the optimization. We have to solve a few thousand parameters in real time. This is a hard problem. And we have made this, and we can show it's like this. So, this is our motion capture room, and the, this person, he's the famous. He's famous tap dancer, and we can measure his motion and visualize the muscle sensations. This is the estimation based on the robotics optimization. This is another case. He is also the quite famous professional drummer, and he's a very talented person. And he doesn't look at the drums, he can just look at the audience. And he explained that he never needs money. Of course, it's not true, but we can visualize how he needs money. And if you carefully look at his way, the when he hit the drum set by the right hand, his best friend is hitting the plant at the same speed. So these are the way how he plays. We can explain this. So now the my colleague, the Dr. Murai, is playing like this. So we can, in real time, compute and optimize the muscle activities. And this is the one of the Olympic athletes, seeking the silver medal in the London. And we have been analyzing the human sensation and applying for the athlete and sport science. Also, we have studied collaboration with biology field, and the I think the it is very hard to actually compare our computation with real sensation muscle of love. And with the collaboration of the biologists, we are establishing the technology to measure the muscle activities of the small animals, and we are trying to compare with the human result. So the to conclude, the human motion is the true of simple systems, and I think the humanoid robots that work in the human environment at home must understand our simple system. It's not very easy. It's only be acquired by observing and communicating with humans. I think this is a challenging field. Also, the human sensations and human muscle neural activities, these can be estimated by computer system and robotics. And this field can find many applications in sports, medicine, biology, including the human and education in the future. Thank you very much. Months before the Olympic, and after getting the silver medal, she was interviewed by the TV, and she said that that visualized, sees the person, and she realized that the muscles on the abdominal muscle was very important and being activated. So in the after this, she trained her abdominal muscles for a few weeks. She was appreciating a lot. Silver. Next time. Yeah.
Would be affected by that, and if you could have certain models of normal behavior versus affected behavior, you think that's something that could assist medicine to predict illnesses and sicknesses?
Yes. We have made several different works, and by looking at the human motions, we are trying to build the low dimensional and maybe human whole body motion is the system of few hundred degrees of freedom, large system. So we cannot visualize, but we can reduce the dimension and we can visualize, for example, in three-dimensional space, trying to compare between a healthy person and some person who have neural disease. Actually, we did some initial work a few years ago. Also, we have now a project with the people working on neuroscience and Parkinson's disease, that the under the project of the supercomputer project of Japan, it's a huge project, and we have been involving to develop the mathematical model of Parkinson's disease and offering the high of pharmaceutical applications.
Thank you very much. I think we'll stop here, and let's thank the speaker again.